no one should doubt that this is an economic opportunity that's greater than anything that's happened in New Zealand's history. We've got to move quickly, and we've got to do it in a very concerted way. So, in a trade preservation sense, the last big diplomatic effort by New Zealand was when Britain joined the EU. This one is a great trade growth opportunity, and it's going to require more resourcing, it's got to happen quicker, but the outcomes are going to be far greater for New Zealand than what we managed to preserve with the EU. If you look at the trend anywhere internationally, as incomes increase, meat becomes a part of the shift in consumer demand. Initially, usually it's in poultry and pork. In the case of China already, pork is the number one consumed meat. But what we're seeing as an advantage for New Zealand is the growth in beef. So if you look at the beef story, only 8% of meat in China is consumed as beef-based. And beef has the advantage over, say, pork or chicken in that the bulk of it is eaten outside the home, quick service stores, etc. So what New Zealand has the chance is to be a part of, first of all, as an ingredient to supply that business, but also the upmarket restaurant trade. And to do that, we have to have improved market access. That is still an issue. FTA is the journey towards zero tariffs. So if you look at beef, for example, the tariffs range from 12 to 25%. Sheep meat's not much different. The maximum tariff on sheep meat's 23%. By 2016, they're all zero rated. So our competitors are still going to be stuck with the tariffs that are there. The point is, though, that as far as China is concerned, the bulk of red meat going into China, we're not talking about poultry or talking about pork, which New Zealand doesn't export. The bulk of that goes through illegal or grey channels. So the regulatory change that's now occurring in China is going to change that, and we're going to have a greater opportunity to bring home the advantages of the FTA. It's going to be a bumpy road. The reality is that agriculture everywhere, doesn't matter what, the regulators will try to look at looking after their domestic industry. But when it comes to beef and to sheep meat, there China has big problems. It is basically a poultry and pork producing country, largely pork. They do have large vertically integrated businesses, but when you look at the beef and sheep sector, it is really undeveloped and not very modern. There are exceptions. You do see some rather top class facilities, but these are quite the exception. And so the test is, going forward, consumers are heading towards wanting more red meat. In the case of beef, only 8% of consumption per capita of meat in China is beef, and most of that is eaten outside the home. So with the changing dietary changes in China, clearly that presents a huge opportunity. To move up the value chain, you have to invest in activities beyond the slaughter and processing area. So we are doing that in ANZCO Foods, and we do that through manufactured foods plants, we do that through bioextract activities, we do that through health-related activities as well. So those opportunities are going to happen more and more in China, and it's a matter of us, though, making sure we get the access. The difficulty so far for us is that elsewhere in the world, we usually set up our own import and distribution activities. We own them ourselves. But in China, we're still worried about the regulatory environment and don't have the certainty in terms of our own market access position. We certainly couldn't do what we did, say, in Korea, in that we contracted processing and undertook that in terms of delivering finished products into the Japanese market. We wouldn't be able to do that at this stage in China. There's just too many issues around labour and internal regulatory relations. So we're waiting to get more certainty, and we believe that the due diligence process, as a new due diligence process, as it has been described, is going to see better clarity in terms of the regulatory environment. Once we know that, then we'll be prepared to do more in terms of our investment in the market. At the moment, our real launch place is from Taiwan. We've had an office there since 1991. Some people may say that's unusual. Why would you use Taiwan? But actually, we're talking about the Greater China, and the trend in China, mainland China, there's no reason why it's not going to mimic what's gone on in Taiwan, what's gone on in Singapore, and what, of course, has gone on in Hong Kong.